Good morning. It's a honor and a privilege to participate in this conference from a distance. I'm sorry, not live, but I will attend as much as I can from a distance. My paper, Jewish Commemoration of the Holocaust in Vilnius, 1944 to 1949, deals with a very short but very important period of time immediately after the war, how Jews attempted to commemorate the events of the Holocaust in Vilnius right after the war. And I will be mainly showing you slides as I speak. When the city of Vilnius was liberated from German occupation on July 13, 1944, there were virtually no Jews in the city. In the course of the next few years, Jews flocked into Vilnius from hiding places and partisan units in the forests, from evacuation in Central Asia, and from liberated Nazi concentration camps. In addition, Soviet Jews from Russia and Belarus also settled in the city. By 1946, there were roughly 9,000 Jews in Vilnius, approximately 7% of the city's total population. The Jewish population reached a peak of 16,000 in the 1959 census. One of the arriving Jews' priorities was to memorialize the pre-war Vilna Jewish community and to commemorate the suffering, mass murder, and armed resistance of their brethren. This natural desire to commemorate was, however, difficult to realize because Vilnius was now under Soviet rule. Cultural life in general, and Jewish cultural life in particular, were controlled by the authorities. Public memory of the war years was an important topic, ideologically, and it needed to conform to a Soviet patriotic formula. And part of that formula was the claim that all Soviet nationalities had suffered equally under German occupation, and that the mass murder of the Jews should not be singled out from the suffering of other peaceful Soviet citizens. Some early official publications passed over the Holocaust in Vilnius altogether. For example, the interim report of the Lithuanian SSR's Extraordinary State Commission to Study the Atrocities by the Germans and their Accomplices, the ČGK, the Čezvyčajnaya Gosudarstvennaya Komissiya, this interim report, which was published in booklet form in 1945, and its section on Panerai wrote, I quote, "Among the victims, there were scholars and workers, engineers and students, Catholic priests and Russian Orthodox priests. On certain bodies, objects of religious worship from the Catholic and Russian Orthodox churches were found. There was no mention of Jews, who constituted the majority of those murdered at Panerai." Under the newly established Soviet regime, there were only three public Jewish institutions in Vilnius: the synagogue, the Jewish Children's Combine, which brought together an orphanage, a kindergarten, and a 5-year school, and Jewish Museum. The authorities rejected requests to establish a Yiddish newspaper, a Yiddish magazine, publishing house, theater, radio broadcasts, a Jewish committee, or a Jewish workers' club. The synagogue and the museum both engaged in commemorative activity, most of the time separately and differently, since they represented different segments of the Jewish community, and also because they had different legal statuses and social positions. But sometimes these two institutions worked quietly together. The synagogue, which was initially headed by the young Rabbi Israel Gustman, who was the only surviving member of the pre-war Vilna rabbinate, the synagogue organized the first public memorial gathering at Panerai on September 20th, 1944, which was Tzom Gedalia, which is a day of fasting and mourning on the Jewish religious calendar. This gathering bore a mixed religious secular character, with men covering their heads in accordance with religious tradition and the recitation of traditional memorial prayers, while the crowd stood around one of the open pits. But the gathering was also addressed by two surviving members of Vilnius's secular Jewish intelligentsia, the medical physician Dr. Alexander Libot and the poet Shmerke Kaczerginski. And the latter, the secular intelligentsia speakers, both called upon Jews to take up arms to defeat the enemy in the ranks of the Red Army, and to take revenge against known local murderers. Many of the synagogue's routine religious services during the course of the year were in fact, in part, Holocaust commemorations, because synagogue attendance shot up on those religious holidays when memorial prayers for the dead were recited. Jews attended those services not so much to pray as to pay their respects to their murdered loved ones. The synagogue seems to have had greater freedom in organizing public Holocaust commemorations than the Jewish Museum did. Thus, the synagogue organized a funeral and burial of desecrated Torah scrolls and Torah scroll fragments in May 1945. Which attracted more than 100 people. This event, the burial of the Torah scrolls, featured a ceremony at the Choral Synagogue on Pilimo Street, a procession through the ghetto with a stop at the building of the Great Synagogue, where eulogies were given, and from there to the Zarecze Uzupis Jewish Cemetery, where burial and recitation of prayers took place. Because religious study and religious book culture had constituted such a prominent feature of Jewish life in pre-Holocaust Vilnius, the burial of the Torah scrolls, of these desecrated Torah scrolls, was a kind of funeral for the spiritual aspect of the Jerusalem of Lithuania itself. Meanwhile, secular public events on the Holocaust faced much firmer bureaucratic opposition. In July 1946, a group of former Jewish partisans tried to organize with the Jewish Museum a program in memory of Itzik Wittenberg, the martyred commander of the FPO, that is the underground armed resistance in the Vilnius ghetto. The purpose of this public program was to recount the struggles of the FPO and of its fallen heroes. Now, Wittenberg should have been a perfect candidate for Soviet glorification, since he was a devoted communist and a leader of the underground Communist Party under the German occupation. But the first secretary of the Vilnius Committee of the Communist Party, the Gorkom, Chistyakov, politely rejected his former partisans' request. And he explained that singling out the struggle of one nationality was unacceptable in the Soviet Union. Only an internationalist program on the partisans of all nationalities was permissible. From that point on, the Jewish Museum refrained from sponsoring public programs on the Holocaust. The museum was much more successful at commemorating the Holocaust through its permanent exhibition, which it began to mount at the end of 1945. The exhibit was at first entitled, quote, German Mass Murder on Lithuanian Soil and Resistance to the Occupation. And it was later renamed much more succinctly, Fascism is Death. This exhibit evolved and grew over time, and it eventually spread over seven rooms. Fascism is Death, we can reconstruct this exhibit from descriptions in the Yiddish press at that time, both the Moscow Yiddish press and the American Yiddish press, from memoirs of staff members of the Jewish Museum and of visitors, and most importantly, from more than 100 photographs of this exhibit taken by the museum's director, Yanko Gutkovich. These photographs were given to me by Gutkovich's daughter, Dina Gutkovich-Krusin, who lives in Princeton, New Jersey. The basic structure of this exhibit is clear. The largest display room was dedicated to the Vilnius ghetto. The second room dealt with Hungary and the labor camps in Estonia to which Jews were deported. Yet another room was devoted to the Kovno Kaunas ghetto, the Ninth Ward, and other ghettos in Lithuania. There were smaller areas dedicated to German atrocities across Europe, including the death camp in Auschwitz, Majdanek, Treblinka. Finally, there was a room dedicated to the struggle of Jewish partisans against the Nazis and Jewish fighters in the Red Army. So the exhibit featured a large number of text panels with narratives and chronologies on the history of the Vilnius and Kaunas ghettos in three languages, Yiddish, Russian, and Lithuanian. Fascism is death is an extremely rare instance of public education on the Holocaust in the Soviet Union, a country where the Jewish genocide was usually downplayed in public discourse and was usually merged into the broader category of the suffering of the Soviet people. In Fascism is Death, the focus was squarely on the fate of the Jews. In this context, I want to point out two key features of this exhibit. First, it fused the Jewish Holocaust narrative with the Soviet war narrative. The exhibit exuded with Soviet patriotism and celebrated the Red Army and Communist Party. Writing in the Moscow Yiddish newspaper Einikeit, Gutkovich, the museum's director, explained the message he hoped visitors would extract from the exhibit, and I quote, "As one walks from room to room, one is overcome with a feeling of passionate love and profound gratitude to the Red Army and to Soviet power, which rescued us from destruction and which now leads us to a new full-blooded life." The exhibit stressed the leading role of the Communist Party in the armed resistance to the German occupation. The exhibit lavished attention on Itzhak Wittenberg, the first commander of the FBO, the ghetto underground. And it celebrated Sonia Madejskar and Chaim Yelin, communists who were leaders of the Jewish armed resistance in Vilnius and Kaunas. The text panel on Wittenberg falsely claimed that the resistance in Vilnius was organized by the Communist Party. There was no mention in the exhibit of Wittenberg's successor as commander of the FPO, Abba Kovner, who was the leader of the socialist Zionist Shomer HaTzair organization, or for that matter of any other FPO leaders who were Zionists or Bundists, Bundists being Jewish social democrats. Integral to this merging of the Holocaust with the Soviet war narrative was the exhibit's primary focus on the Holocaust in Soviet Lithuania, and then its secondary focus on other parts of the Soviet Union. European countries outside the USSR, including Poland, were given very scant attention. This exhibit began with the German attack on the Soviet Union in June 1941, not with the German invasion of Poland in September 1939. For atrocities across the Soviet Union, the exhibit featured images collected and given on loan by the Soviet Jewish writer Ilya Ehrenburg. While there was also a photo montage on Auschwitz, and items from Treblinka donated by the Soviet Jewish writer Vasily Grossman, there was no narrative, there was no text panels about Auschwitz and Treblinka. The viewer either knew or had to guess that there was a comprehensive Nazi final solution to the Jewish question, because it was not mentioned. The curators could not talk about the Holocaust as a pan-European phenomenon, because that would be wading into politically perilous territory. Any reference to the Jews of Europe as a single entity which shared a common fate would have been an impermissible expression of Jewish nationalism in the USSR. Now, a second major feature of fascism is death was its immediate proximity to the events. This exhibit was opened in late 1945, and the rawness of the curator's emotions. The Jewish Museum, this museum, was located within the territory of the former Vilna ghetto at 6 Strashun Street. The main building, which was now the Jewish Museum, had functioned as the ghetto library, which was the cultural and social hub, focal point for ghetto inmates. In front of the building, there was a cleared away area, which was used as the ghetto sports field. And there was an attached adjacent wing, which was the ghetto prison, many of whose arrestees were seized by the Germans and sent to their deaths in Panerai. So the history of the Vilna ghetto, the Vilnius ghetto, was encapsulated in the address of the museum, 6 Strashun Street, which now became a museum. In fact, during the first months of the museum's existence, the only place, the only rooms in usable condition were the prison cells. And those became the staff offices. Gutkovich, the director, and his staff worked in the cells whose walls bore handwritten inscriptions by prison inmates. Tomorrow will be taken to Panerai. Take revenge for the innocent blood. Truth will prevail. Down with Jens. The inscriptions were photographed, and some of them were displayed in the exhibit hall, which was just a few dozen meters away. Now, Fascism is Death, this exhibit, was far less inhibited than later Holocaust exhibits throughout the world, because the curators had no aesthetic or moral compunctions just to display items that would nowadays be rejected because they elicit revulsion or they violate the dignity of the victims. The exhibit displayed, in a case, a woman's skull from Ponar, Panerai, with a bullet hole in the back of her head. In the next room, there was a bar of soap, which the exhibit reported was produced from the fat of murdered Jews at a factory in Danzig. Another featured item was the text of a letter written on the train to Panerai by two members of a large group of Jews who had been in hiding. And their hiding place was discovered in 1944, several months before the ghetto's liquidation. Several months after the ghetto's liquidation. The group included women and children, and the letter gave graphic descriptions of the gang rape of young girls by German soldiers and Lithuanian policemen in the presence of their mothers. And it described the mutilation of male sexual organs with wires and rods. Now, the exhibit not only displayed this letter, originally a Polish language letter, but it also provided panels around the display with full translations of its text into Russian, Yiddish, and Lithuanian, including the descriptions of rape and sexual mutilation. By contrast, when this letter was published in a book in New York in Yiddish in 1947, the editors deleted those passages and gave an explanatory note, I quote from the New York book. "We cannot bring the next lines because one cannot put in print the sadistic sexual practices of the German murderers and degenerates toward children." The curators of Fascism is Death were filled with a passion to expose the vile nature of the Germans' crimes And this passion was unchecked by any other considerations. They wanted to shock their audience. And that was a tall order, since the viewers of this exhibit had themselves witnessed death and brutality during the war years. Staff member Alexander Rinzunsky, a former ghetto inmate and a former FPO fighter, served as the museum's tour guide. And Rinzunsky reported in his memoirs that many of the viewers of this exhibit were visitors from other parts of the Soviet Union, Jews and non-Jews from Moscow, Leningrad, Kharkov, and elsewhere. Non-Jewish visitors expressed astonishment at the Germans' crimes against the Jewish people, saying that they had never heard or read of them in the Soviet press. Among the VIP prominent visitors to this exhibit were the president of Soviet Lithuania, Justas Paleckis, and the director of the Moscow State Yiddish Theater, Solomon Michoels. Once memorializing the destruction of Lithuanian Jewry became the Jewish Museum's primary objective, this mission led the museum to go beyond its own four walls and concern itself with the mass murder at Panerai, the mass murder site at Panerai. On July 27, 1946, the museum's director, Janko Gutkovich, and the five members of the museum's board sent a memorandum about Panerai to Paleckis and other Lithuanian Soviet officials. The memo noted that more than 100,000 Soviet citizens had been killed there, 70,000 of whom were Jews. Panerai is dear to thousands of people, unquote, because of the innocent blood and their family members and dear ones that was spilled there. The memo called on the Council of Ministers of the Lithuanian SSR to build fences around the mass murder pits in order to stop ongoing scavengering and looting at the site. It urged the authorities to place a memorial sign immediately and eventually erect a monument there. Paleckis was sympathetic to the museum's proposal and helped arrange a meeting between a representative of the museum and Deputy Prime Minister of the Lithuanian SSR, Girdvainis. At the meeting, the museum submitted a detailed proposal for a monument with a budget and architectural plans. Girdvainis left the room to consult with Prime Minister Mečislovas Gedvilas in private. When he returned, he thanked the museum for its initiative and promised to convene a consultation on the matter of Panerai. But the consultation never took place. This meeting was a polite brush off. The museum's entreaties failed to bear fruit, but they did set into motion a dynamic which eventually led to success. After a year of government inaction, the Jewish religious community, the synagogue, entered the fray and took up this failed cause. It applied to the Council for the Affairs of Religious Cults and requested authorization to put in order the mass graves at Panerai and to construct a monument there. The synagogue argued that Panerai was a Jewish cemetery and that the construction of a tombstone on the grave of loved ones was a religious due. This request was eventually approved in May 1948, and the monument was erected in August of 1948. Its text of this Jewish monument at Panerai from 1948 was in Yiddish, Hebrew, and Russian, and it specified that it was in memory of the Jews murdered by the German fascists. It invoked the biblical verse on the murder of Abel by his brother Cain. The voice of the innocent's blood cries out from the ground. There was no hammer and sickle, no Soviet star. This was a Jewish tombstone, not a Soviet monument. The Jewish Museum in Vilnius was dissolved as part of the campaign that liquidated all Jewish cultural institutions in the Soviet Union during the final years of Stalin's rule. All Jewish cultural institutions in the Soviet Union were liquidated in 1949. In January 1949, the Minister of State Security of the Lithuanian SSR wrote a memo on the peril of Zionism and Jewish nationalism in Soviet Lithuania. In this memo, the Minister of State Security condemned the Jewish Museum's exhibit for its one-sided, quote-unquote, presentation. He claimed the exhibit created the impression that only Jews fought against the German occupiers, while Lithuanian nationalists actively participated in the atrocities against Jews. This was a patently false characterization of the exhibit, but it served its purpose. The museum was ordered closed on June 10, 1949. Quite remarkably, and in stark contrast to events in Moscow and Kiev, none of the Vilnius Jewish Museum staff members were arrested. Lefkovich, the director, found employment as a haircut norm regulator, who checked that barbers filled out their quotas of haircuts according to the five-year plan. The Jewish monument at Panerai, erected in 1948, was dynamited by the authorities in 1952. It was replaced by a new monument with a Soviet star on top and a brief inscription in Russian and Lithuanian to the victims of fascist terror. There was no Yiddish, no Hebrew, no mention of Jews. The work of the Vilnius Jewish Museum and of the synagogue to commemorate the Holocaust had been undone. From that point on, the Holocaust became a matter of private memory and not of public commemoration. Thank you, and I wish you.